Greetings, and welcome to the Thirsty Mage, the podcast still trying to figure out how to patch in a rewind function to our original Nintendo Entertainment System. I'm your host of this large gathering of Nintendo fans, David Loy, and we're celebrating both the 35th anniversary of The Legend of Zelda and the 250th episode of the Talk Nintendo podcast by playing Zelda 2, The Adventure of Link. In anticipation of the game's upcoming release as a Nintendo Game & Watch, we gave this title another try, and we'll be talking about that experience today. Starting with the introductions of this large gathering is the man crazy enough to have actually beaten this back in the day before the age of rewind. It's Jordan Rudick.
So I've got a cool little anecdote about why that happened or how that happened. So it probably took me a while, but
Game
my
Genie?
Dad... Yeah, exactly. That wouldn't take very long. I would just admit to cheating right away. No, my dad somehow... I don't know if he blew up like pages of the manual or if it was from Nintendo Power or something, but we had like these pages of like some kind of strategy or tips or whatever, and it had all these different creatures in the game, and so he would print them out at work or photocopy them or blow them up, and we kind of made like a coloring book out of it, sort of. So it was a cool little binder filled with like I don't know if it was just the manual or like a bestiary or whatever, but like I remember getting really into that element of it too, kind of, you know, the art of the game, I guess, the style of it. And I think we spent a lot of time either talking about the game or playing it together. So I'll give credit to my dad on this one. A belated Father's Day shout out to him. But that was one of my fondest memories as a kid. One of my earliest memories as a kid playing video games with him, and just in general, was this whatever guide he kind of made up that turned into an art book of sorts. So that's probably how I got through it before we had a rewind function. And I'm sure it took a long time, but. Yeah, I was happy to get back to it. I really, really like this game.
So what you're saying is that your nostalgia book goggles are about as thick as a beer bottle.
Yeah, for this one, it's definitely looking at it with some pink colored glasses here. But I don't know. There's a lot that I like about this game. Like I see all the flaws. I get it. I think if people haven't played, I think the SP version on the Nintendo Switch Online is a pretty cool one, because you start with max. Power, heart, I guess, defense, and magic efficiency, or whatever the stats we want to call them. But so that's a cool way to go through it. I didn't try that for this one, but I did think about it.
And we'll introduce the big Nintendo Talk Nintendo podcast, and we'll start off with the busiest man in podcasting, since he's doing crossovers each and every week. It's Casey Gibson.
Yeah, well, it sounded like to me, Jordan, is that you were cheating, and your dad just put it under the guise of some sort of art book, but he was cheating for you. But no, I don't know if what's more painful, that some of your fondest memories is of Zelda 2 growing up, or that I have to watch sports from the New York area and my whole life, and it sucks.
Yeah, I was punished by playing Zelda 2, and you were punished by watching the Islanders lose 8-0 last night. So there's going to be a lot of punishment talk tonight.
It was 6-0 as far as I'm concerned.
Well, now that we got the comparison of how painful it is playing Zelda 2, we can move on to the from the busiest man in podcasting to the busiest man in game development, Talk Nintendo host and creative director at Atui, Perry Burkham.
Oh. Who are you people? Where am I?
Shut up.
Who
Jerry.
Am I? Jerry, you say. Well, how's it going? How's it going, everyone? How's it going, Canadians? How's it going, Americans?
How you doing?
Pretty
Perry?
Good. Feeling good.
I think a congratulations is in
Thank
order.
Thank you. For
those who don't know, Perry and Game Dex announced the latest Game Dex version with a crossover of Yooka-Laylee. It looks really cool. I was watching watched the video today, and props to you guys. Congratulations. That it looks like a really cool project.
Thank you. It's been very fun. Very, very fun.
Yeah. It has been fun for us, hasn't it?
Yes.
And we did really do it.
Host also here.
I think Alex, I think the next person deserves the most credit for said announcement.
And he's making his first appearance on the Thirsty Mage, the newest host of the Talk Nintendo podcast, just in time for the big 250. It's Alex Kalafi.
Hi there. It's nice to meet you, David. And Jordan, I met the other day. So I'm fully integrated now, and I'm That's so right. excited to be here and talk about my favorite video game, which I definitely didn't play for 10 minutes before starting this recording.
And by the way, Alex, just to let you know, David is also Canadian, no joke.
Yeah. Oh, I could tell immediately.
Oh, okay.
When you say you're here to talk about your favorite video game, does that mean you're going to be talking about something else?
No.
Final Fantasy 14.
Would you shut up about No More Heroes, Alex?
That is true. He is a No More Heroes fiend.
No, I am here to talk about Hotline Miami. You guys can talk about whatever you guys want.
It's basically the same game.
It sounds like I'm going to be doing a lot of heavy lifting this episode, so I better start, stretching or, getting limber here.
Well, you might as well get us started with the drinks and snacks. Have you any Oreo scores this weekend at the?
No, I don't have anything fun. And I used my walking story last week. I got nothing. I will give a I'm full of shout outs today. Everyone gets shout outs. I'm feeling like Oprah tonight. I just got for Father's Day. I got one of these. I don't know what you would call them. Like, they're these kind of tiny wallets that they're not like a traditional like folding wallet. I guess they look like a credit card size, and you just kind of stick your cards in the middle and then push them up. So I got one of those for Father's Day for my wife, and I'm still kind of working out the kinks. But man, it's nice to not have like a bulky wallet filled with a ton of stuff in my pocket anymore. Like, I feel like my pants aren't just like bulging out the sides. Like, I've got like sandbags in them or something like that. So
I got one of those.
Nice. Yeah, it's nice. I've been looking at it for a few months now, and so I ended up asking for one, and yeah, I'm digging it. Just need to figure out how to whip it out fast and not pull out like all the cards at once when I just want to grab the card in the front.
Just make sure you're not near a school, you perv.
What? Yeah, unfortunately, I do live like 10 steps from a school, so I guess just keep it between
us. I would say
you
don't want to be put on a list.
Like,
but,
that was an accident.
Yeah. I was a trifold guy forever, as far as my wallet went. And then I got a bifold for Christmas, and normally I'm not a bifold kind of guy, but I tell you what, it is nice not sitting on like one cheek on a mountain, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was tired of that. Like, I like to have all my like gift cards in there, my stamp cards. I don't want to miss out on getting a stamp if I'm buying something. So to kind of do a big what's the Marie Kondo purge here of all my cards and gift cards and stuff like that. So I've slimmed down. I think I've got like 7 cards in here now, a little bit of money on the back, and good to go. Just feels nice. I feel like a weight has lifted off my shoulders here. So, or I guess off my pants or something, but whatever.
Well, I definitely like having the metal wallet myself, because if I ever have to like pull out a ninja star and toss it at somebody, I'm all set.
Oh, this is gonna hurt a lot. This is gonna hurt a lot more. If someone cuts you off and you want to smash their window or something like that, you just take your cards out and chuck the wallet at them.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. NFC protected.
It's definitely a projectile now. Yeah. Much more so than the original wallet.
Well, Alex, as the newbie to the mage, I know you had told us beforehand that you have a beer. Why don't you kick us off with the beer discussion, since Jordan doesn't have the food this week?
Sure. So I need to admit, first and foremost, to ruin all the goodwill I've had on this show, I've never listened to a Thirsty Mage episode before, but I assumed, based on the title and a little line in the outline, that I was supposed to have a beer today. So I went to my fridge and I picked the most interesting beer I could find, and I'm currently drinking it. It is a Left Hand Milk Stout. Have you heard of them?
Not that one. I've heard of milk stouts, though.
Okay, so Left Hand Milk Stout. Left Hand is a brewer out in Colorado, that's in the United States, and I'm trying to be silly here. I assume you've heard of Colorado, but this is a milk stout.
So nothing below Buffalo they've heard of.
Only
so.
The hockey team.
So it's brewed with lactose, which gives it a little bit of a sweeter flavor, and this one's a chai flavor. So. As a stout, it's a little bit heavy, a little bit bitter, and the chai, with the creaminess, makes it really, really nice. So, if you like your stouts,
and you haven't tried a milk stout, I first and foremost recommend a milk stout because they're a lot of fun. But if you do have access to left-hand milk stout, try the chai one because it's a really nice desserty beer, which I think is a thing now. I think desserty stouts is like a thing that's happening nowadays.
Yeah, is that the one that's also a nitro beer, isn't it?
Yep, it absolutely is.
Yeah,
so or one using... of them is. Yeah, I know they do it.
Yeah, because that's both of those are kind of, I guess, it with the kind of rise of the craft beer, I guess, that's definitely like the milk stout is really, really popular these days. I see a lot of those kinds of stouts up here, too. Through our microbreweries, and yeah, I know nitrogen is a big thing too. Using getting the nitro beer is definitely. I don't know if I necessarily see much of a difference between regular carbonation and nitrogen, but
sounds cooler.
I do like the milk stout though.
Well,
have you have you had one of those Guinness cans that has the little nitrogen ping pong ball in it?
Because
it makes it so much better. Like, it makes it pretty similar to having a Guinness in a bar.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, is I think it's, like, if you're getting it from a can, I guess it makes a difference, because it makes it seem a little, I don't know if fresher is the better word, but it's at least closer to getting something from, like, a tap.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that's where the benefit comes from, but, like, there's a cafe here, like, little itty-bitty cafe, and they have, like, one beer, and it's a nitro beer, so it's just a kind of a weird thing. Well, and even, I don't know about the Starbucks down in the States, but I know up in Canada, they started selling nitro beer in Starbucks, too.
Beer? Because I know they do cold brew.
Yeah, no, we have some Starbucks here that actually sell beer.
Oh, that's cool. Mm.
I think Dave is just so much of a lush that all the places around him have started stocking beer because they know he'll come in and buy it.
The whales.
A Canada wide thing or a province wide thing. It's just really like David, like a 30-mile radius around David's house or something.
Maybe
like
that's why David hasn't gotten into mobile gaming, because he's just a big whale. He already knows that he's going to end up spending all that loot.
Yeah. You can chart the rise of microbreweries in the Ottawa area to like the radius of my home.
Yeah. Like I could just see like in the back room of like some like alcohol distribution plant, they've got like your picture on a wall and like they've drawn a map of like where they can strategically put alcohol and beer to get the most money out of you or something.
He drops the kids off here and then he's on the way home. He's going to be thirsty. There's like eight different spots on the way home. But I tell you what, to jump ship sort of as we were talking, I heard cold brew. And I'm on a cold brew kick right now. Wendy's surprisingly has a pretty good cold brew, guys. Don't sleep on it.
That's the most random place you could have named. If you had said, like, I've been, getting cold brew from someplace, you won't guess where it's from. I never would have guessed Wendy's.
I tell you what, it's surprisingly really good. And if you're feeling a little adventurous, you could get the, like, Frostuccino or something. And well, what they do is they give you the cold brew and then they cut it with Frosty. Like,
I love
that. Would be the
I love that idea. That's fantastic.
Yeah, so that's really
now,
good.
Chocolate
too.
Frosty or vanilla Frosty?
Your
or do you have a choice?
Dealer's choice. Well, I guess.
Even better.
Not dealer's, I guess. Buyer's choice.
No, dealer's probably the optimal word here, I'd say.
It's still a dealer's
choice. They're dealing
your
drugs to you, so.
But yeah, I've gotten that and it's very good. But just the true and tried cold brew itself is very delicious as well. But the only bad thing is now, if you have little to no self-control like myself, you end up with a 4-for-4 or a biggie bag to go along with your cold brew there. And yes. I mean, not that it's a bad thing. It's delicious, but I am a little pig boy, so.
But you got a good metabolism, though.
Yeah, I am fortunate with the metabolism on that front. But I do eat way too much fast food.
It sounds like a heart attack in a cup.
Yeah, just about.
You got the ice cream and the cold brew of the caffeine.
It's like the Red Bull vodkas back in the day. It's like slows you up, but also brings you down. Or brings
how
you
else
up.
Are you going to get through like 12 hours of Final Fantasy 14? I mean, this is the only way. So,
Well, I did finish Final Fantasy 7. So, the DLC. So now it's full clear 14.
See, what Casey's not telling you is that there was a Final Fantasy 14 marketing campaign at Wendy's, and that's why he ended up there in the first place.
Like the Butterfingers thing I sent to Paige. If you spend like $5 on Butterfinger or Butterfinger accessories, I guess, you can get like a free in-game chocolate mount of some sort. It's very weird.
That's probably the real story of Casey going to Wendy's, is this concoction of the Frosty and the coffee probably doesn't exist. It was probably Casey going bananas at the Wendy's because they didn't have a Final Fantasy 14 code. And they're like, we got to shut him up.
Just put some Frosty in that cold brew to shut him up, yeah.
The truth is, I'd be really impressed if you brought your own cold brew to Wendy's and then just loaded it up with Frosty. Like, you cut it yourself. Like, I'd be like, I appreciate your ingenuity. That deserves respect.
Well, yes, that's exactly what happened. I meant to say before. I'm sorry.
Pretty sure we're all dressed trying to avoid the Zelda 2 talk at this point, so maybe we should move on.
I hate you guys. Why can't we just enjoy this game? It has a lot of good quality.
It's not that bad. It's not that bad. It turns on.
The temple theme is one of the greatest themes in not just Zelda, but in video games.
That's
it is
music,
so
Jordan.
The game got really good after I beat Dark Link.
Yeah. Yeah, the game was really good when I turned it off and then turned on Final Fantasy 14. But I will say,
yeah, I love the part when you get off the Great Plateau. I don't know what you're talking about. Yeah. This game's amazing.
That's right. Yeah. They've got a highly anticipated sequel coming out next year, or really 2023.
Yeah, I was wondering, how did you guys get all of the Breath of the Wild 2 copies so early? I had to find mine deep in the internet.
All right, Joe, you better kick off the impressions, because we all know you're the highest on this. I don't think we're all that low, but you're the highest,
gonna,
so you might as well.
It's gonna go.
It
it's gonna fall so far down from here, I think. Okay, so I can't believe that on David, you of all people, like on an RPG podcast, and not like the most RPG Zelda that there is. Like, come on, give me a break here. Like, I think the idea of experience points in this game is really cool. Like the idea that you can kind of level up your stat of choice. You know, you don't have to. Not all your stats go up at the same time. Like, you can choose. Do you want to have more defense? You want to be able to cast magic more easily? Or do you want to just keep waiting? Like the attack stat always takes the longest amount or the most amount of experience points to level up. So you could wait for that one, but, you know, it's going to be more of a risk-reward if that's the one you want to power up or prioritize. When you figure out that, like, at the end of every temple, it'll raise you to the next level. And so you kind of manipulate it a little bit to make sure you just leveled up or you got to a point or stopped so that you get the most experience points from completing the temple. I think that's pretty cool, too. Like, I think the whole idea of progression in the game is interesting. And I think it's a shame that there aren't other Zelda games that do that. And it's not just like the experience points and stats. Like, you find heart containers to raise your life meter, you know, very standard Zelda kind of thing. You find magic potion meters or magic potions to raise your magic meter as well.
They even have one-ups, don't they? Which only lasts for the little Link dolls, I think, right? Until you die.
That's right. Yeah, you once you pick one up, I mean, they're gone, and it is only an extra life. But I don't imagine that many of us got much use out of them, given the probably rampant abuse of the rewind function. And I'm not going to pretend I didn't use the rewind function here, but the fact that you have like a very accessible version of the game, two of them actually on NSO. I mean, I think that's a good reason to pick this game up. The progression's good. I think the world can be tricky to explore, and obviously the hints from villages are pretty cryptic. But, you know, the villages provide like a nice respite from, you know, all the danger that you get from walking around in the world. You know, figuring out the secrets and, you know, the different hidden areas and stuff is cool. Death Mountain is a pain in the butt, but, you know, if you've done it before, you know, kind of like the general pattern for it is not too bad. I think the palaces, the temples themselves are fun. Like, I think the combat in this game is enjoyable. I think, you know, there's some parts with like hidden walls and stuff later on that's kind of garbage. And you know, maybe finding all the keys can be a little frustrating. But I think the first few palaces especially are really fun. You know, just kind of going down the elevators and, you know, following a path over the end. The combat is almost always challenging, like especially the dark nuts, you know, the blue ones that throw the daggers at you, they're really tough until your attack stat is higher. You can take them out in a few hits, but I like the combat. I like the, you know, raising your shield, lowering it, you know, chopping up or chopping down depending on you know, which enemy you're fighting. Like, I think all of that stuff's pretty cool. The cheap deaths, you know, getting hit, you know, the Ninja Gaiden type deaths of like getting hit off a ledge or and you fall into the lava. And I'm not going to give any, you know, I'm not going to say anything good about those kind of interstitial areas where you're crossing a bridge or jumping over the pits and the bubbles are coming out of the ground. Yep. And a bubble hits you and you fall and you die. Like, that's garbage. Like, that, there's no getting around that. But I think those kind of elements, there's not too many of them. I think there is more good than bad in this game, ultimately.
I feel like this is Jordan trying to talk Octopath up also. It's like, I see the parallels here for sure.
How did I get to Octopath?
Because the game sucks. No,
what's the Metacritic score of Zelda 2?
What is it?
It came out before Metacritic was a thing.
You can use that one too, Jordan.
If it's above Octopath, Casey's going to eat his words here.
So the classic NES series version of Zelda 2 got a Metacritic.
Uh-oh.
I'm trying to...
How good is that version? I don't even know.
Yeah, I guess just
73.
That's not horrible. That's not horrible.
That's about right.
What's Octo?
I would have thought it'd be lower, honestly.
Octo was in the 80s.
That version doesn't even have rewind in it for safety.
I've been giving you a hard time, Jordan, but playing an old NES game is fun. Like, Zelda 2 is a fun enough game. Like, there, like you said, there's definitely a lot of parts in it that are very irritating. Some of the bosses are. Like, what's funny to me is that the hardest enemies in the game aren't even the bosses. Like, the bosses are the easiest. Like, they're almost as easy as the slime. Like, I thought that was hilarious. But yeah, definitely I guess it's just the combat can kind of grate on me a bit because it's like just randomly going up and down and trying to basically like outfox the the knight or whatever. Like, yeah, like it just feels like I'm kind of just slashing away and hoping for the best. Which at the end of the day, with the rewind function, it's not that big a deal because, like you said, the rewind function eliminates the cheap death. So it definitely greatly improves the game. But yeah, there's a lot to like in it in itself, I suppose. Like, having, like, the overworld mixed in, like, because you have, like, that traditional Zelda overworld when you're out and about. And I like to do, like, the little tricks to kind of get away from the bad guys. Like, so basically, when you're in the overworld, if you're walking on the road, you're always safe. Yep. As soon as you go off of the road, there will be three enemies that kind of just randomly, like, circle around you and try to hit you. And if they actually do touch you, then you end up in kind of, like, this mini, I don't know what you'd call it, like, just, like, a mini battle, I guess, where there's, like, a bunch of enemies and you're basically, your goal is just to get to either the left or the right of the screen to get out. But one of my strategies was always touch the road or, you know, touch off the road, go back onto the road, let them hit me. And then if you're on the road and they hit you, there's no enemies. You can just walk away. And then you get a few extra seconds of them not coming back as they refresh.
Anything not to play the game.
Yeah, exactly. That sounds like a Bostonian cheating method.
Yeah.
Well, what's nice is that other Nintendo Switch Online mode that just gives you the buffs right at
the
beginning.
Great, yeah.
I really felt representation with that mode.
You felt right at home.
Yeah.
I think there are some weird things for sure. I mean, I guess this sort of sticks on the pattern, right? Like, we're just going to give, like, a completely different experience than the first game, right? Like, obviously, a lot of side-scrolling stuff and the RPG elements. It's weird that there's a life system. Like you die the five times or whatever it is, and then you get sent back, and then you lose your experience that you have sort of accumulated. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty punishing. Now, I wonder if this was sort of to combat, again, rentals maybe, right? Like, trying to be like, well, no, this is a tough-as-nails game. You need to buy it to beat it. But I don't know. It feels weird. You know, maybe, like, instead of, like, sending you all the way in the beginning, you know, where you first start the game, like, maybe if you get a game over, oh, you start at the beginning of the dungeon or the beginning of the area you're in, you know, instead of, like, making you have to go all the way back, and then, like, on the way there, right, like, you could lose lives again. So it's definitely very punishing. I mean, obviously, that's very much negated with rewind functions and, you know, save states. So that's not something, like, I'm sure any of us really encountered. But in the original game, right, to have that seems like really brutal. And then I guess, like, even if you think to, like, the Lost Levels, right, like how brutal that was of a follow-up for Mario, so much so that they didn't even release it for the Americans till way later. But, yeah, I don't know, it just seems almost like you could either get rid of that system or just make it a little less punishing, and it, I think, would work out way better, you know?
I mean, Case, it's great that you brought up Lost Levels, because it's almost like we got the Zelda version of Lost Levels. They didn't give us the Super Mario USA version of Zelda 2. You know, we got the genuine article that can be quite punishing. And I'm glad you brought that up, because that's something that if you play this game today, they won't necessarily experience that because of, you know, all the features that have been added to maybe more contemporary versions of it. You might not see the game over Ganon screen where he's kind of laughing at you with that kind of cackle that he does. It's pretty good. Yeah, I don't know. I certainly get the complaints about the difficulty, and yeah, you're right. Maybe it was something to combat rentals, or, you know, they I don't know. I'd love to know, like, the differences between the Japanese release and the Western one. If one is harder than the other, if they did make tweaks to it. The localization obviously is a problem. Like the cryptic hints and tips that the villagers give you. Like, I get it. You know, you're working within, like, text box restrictions, but, like, some of them it doesn't make a lot of sense at all, like, where you're supposed to go from what they're saying. And so I can't imagine, like, how a lot of people figured it out without something like Nintendo Power. This feels like a perfect game to have, like, a, you know, needing that
guide or something,
support, or maybe even, like, calling, like, the Nintendo hit to the Nintendo hint line or the hotline, right, to get feedback. This is probably one of the games that people called in about the most to figure out where they were going to go next, because it is pretty hard to do that. I can't pretend that it's not tricky in those ways. I did want to bring up, David, you talked about that trick of, like, running back to the road to avoid an enemy encounter. Another thing you can do in that vein is if you're late, especially later on in the game, you want to avoid some of those trap spots where you have to, like, do the jumping and avoid the bubbles, or later on your way to the final temple where all the lizards are throwing, I don't know if you guys played this far, you remember this part, but all the lizards throwing the fire rocks at you from behind the wall. You can skip some of that stuff by getting a combat encounter on the same square as a trap that is a trap. So you kind of lure one of the three random creatures into that spot, and you walk on it on the same moment, and then you can just do, like, the simple combat routine rather than doing, like, going through the whole like little trap stage. So that was kind of a funny thing that I was trying to do on my way to Death Mountain during this playthrough. I don't know if anyone has tried that or saw something like that.
Yeah,
there's little tricks like that. Yeah.
Well, there are two Discord members that agree with you, Jordan, and I just want to read what they had to say, because you need some backup here.
So I think we need to replace the regular members of this podcast with some of our Discord friends.
So Chris says, Zelda 2 does have some of my favorite gaming memories. I think it was the first game where I encountered enemies that changed their attacks, requiring me to change my own approach, and this blew my mind as a kid. I learned some cool moves from old guys hidden in caves, which allowed me to kick more butt. Overall, that sense of place, I think, is what really kept me playing Zelda 2. Reading clues, while just flat out being told what to do most of the time from the same three villagers, trudging through the huge overworld to find the right path and grind experience, entering a palace and hearing the music change. It just felt like a big adventure all the time.
Yeah, It's a great world for sure. Sorry, I just want to respond to that one before you go to the next one. I think the idea of like focusing on the environment of the world of Hyrule here, I think is really cool. I think the map has a lot of personality. You know, taking the raft over to like a whole new continent with its own towns, and the idea that you, unless you die, you might not come back. There's no reason to really backtrack to the beginning continent. So when you take that raft over, it does feel like a whole new world in a way. And you're gonna, you know, this is where the kind of final battles are going to take place, the final towns you're gonna meet, the final palaces. So I agree with calling out, this is a really cool version of the Zelda world that you know, maybe that part doesn't get a lot of credit. There's a ton of like maybe environmental storytelling that's going on with just the world map itself, like where the graveyard is, and kind of walking through the getting the boots so you can walk through the water, and you need to do that to find some secrets and then get to the water palace or something like that. So yeah, a lot of cool elements just in the world map itself.
Yeah, I was going to say, I wouldn't mind seeing them bring back those water boots so that you could walk on water. That would be a pretty neat thing that you could do in
I guess they're kind of like the float. Aren't they like floating boots in Ocarina of Time? Like, they're kind of like that a little bit? Or is that Majora's Mask? I don't even remember. But there's boots where you can float like a little bit, like a few steps.
Oh, yeah, like when you run off the edge or something.
Kind of like that, yeah.
Yeah, and just before we get to the, you know, more Discord stuff, just while we're talking about the world, It compared to the first one, right, it's not as linear, I mean, or it's way more linear, I should say, than the first one, because the, you know, obviously Zelda 1, you could do anything and everything really right off the bat, where this one, it's definitely more segmented, like, hey, you're going to go here, you're going to do this, oh, there's a roadblock, you know, you need to get the hammer or whatever it was to break it, you know, and like, it's very much making sure you're checking the boxes along the way before you sort of access a new area. And I think that probably has something to do with the level system in general, right? I mean, if you're not, like, if you're leveling up or not leveling up, right, like, you would just get hammered if you just went to, you know, later into the game. So it just sort of interesting to see what a different sort of philosophy from the first game to the second one. I mean, it's sort of everything's different. So I guess it shouldn't really, you know, surprise us, I guess.
I looked into the regional differences. Sorry, mentioned
there
it.
There we go.
Yep.
A lot of it's visual. Mm-hmm. There are some technical stuff, like the water doesn't animate in the NES version, but it does in the Famicom version. But it is easier in places in the NES version. Mm. For example, the Dark Link fight at the very end.
Yep.
The Dark Link trick where you can just stand on the left side of the map. Yep, that's only in the NES version.
Oh, really? That's interesting. That fight is so hard. Like, I tried like half a dozen times to do it without
that
the trick.
Cheesing.
I'm like, oh, you know, just to see if I can do it without cheesing. It is so hard. Oh my gosh, I don't know how you do it, but
the thing I thought was funny about Link in this one is that I noticed that Link, by virtue of the way that it's set up, is that depending on which way you're facing, Link will switch which hand has the sword and which hand has the shield.
Right. Skills.
Which I think is hilarious. Yeah. He's ambidextrous. Like, and just flips on the fly. I think it's pretty funny. Destroys the cannon.
There's a lot of other touches like that too. Did you notice that Link has momentum in the game? Almost like New Super Mario Bros.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where if he runs and then you just let go for a second, he'll go a couple more steps.
You can also jump higher, I think. Yeah, you can jump a little higher too.
Yep. Yeah, there's a momentum to the jumps. So I'll go ahead and get into it. So Brendan also gave us his take on Zelda 2. So his first memory of Zelda 2 was looking at the screenshots in the back of a box of the NES that his older brother borrowed from their uncle in the late 90s, which they still have to almost three decades later. He says, I didn't get a chance to play it until the early 2010s when it made its way available on the 3DS for Ambassadors. During the first year of the 3DS, I survived the software wasteland by diving into the classic NES and GBA games that were there on offer, spending countless hours on Metroid, F-Zero Maximum Velocity, Fire Emblem, The Sacred Stones, and Zelda 2. Compared to Zelda 1, which didn't grab me at all, I fell in love with Zelda 2. Whilst I relied upon a walkthrough and save states to get through the game, Zelda 2 truly does feel like embarking on an adventure. From its dual gameplay modes, brilliant music compositions, and its difficulty, while very hard, isn't insurmountable. The different locations and enemies you encounter, coupled with their varying attack patterns, allows for a level of strategy that is not excessive like many NES hard games. It is a game where you can master its combat system, and there's nothing more satisfying than the moment that you've learned how to play the game well, that enemies like the Dark Nuts can be defeated with ease. a feeling that he didn't feel during the playing a Zelda game, defeating Guardians in Breath of the Wild. My main gripe would be the asinine puzzle designs that is very reminiscent of Castlevania 2 Simon's Quest. If I hadn't been using a walkthrough, I'd doubtlessly still be wandering through that overworld map to this day.
Yeah, yeah. I remember, I guess, like, I didn't play all the way through, so I was just, you know, scrolling around and watching some later footage of it, too, and reading about it, too. And I guess there was a spot where you need to find, like, one tile within the forest to get something that, like, is integral to beating the game, you know? And it's just, like, the only hint is sort of like, hey, it's in the forest, and like, nothing else, and no visual cues or anything like that. Very obtuse. And for me, I think that's where, like, to me, that's where these older Zelda games sort of lose me a little bit. Not so much even how difficult or, you know, maybe... I mean, this one is definitely... Without the save states, I think I would never even really want to attempt to play very much of it. But just, like, yeah, I hate having to play with a guide, more or less, you know? Or, like, oh, I don't need a guide, and then, like, every freaking 5-10 minutes, I'm like, oh, well, let me just go check something, you know? And I gotta freaking pull up the tab again. Ugh.
Yeah, totally.
I'd completely forgot playing this game that one of the towns you can only find by... smashing the trees in the forest with your hammer. I totally forgotten you could even do that. I'm like, where is this town? Like, I played the game a bunch of times. Like, where's this town? Where's this town? I'm like, oh, right. You can knock the trees down with your hammer. Like, I'm sure probably one NPC in the game probably tells you that. But, like, the rocks, it makes sense to break with a hammer. But, like, chopping down the trees with a hammer seems kind of, you know, not so intuitive.
Look at it. Jordan doesn't have his cheating book, and he's already forgetting all the info.
I need to find my art book from the photo.
I think the most egregious one, though, is I can't remember. I think it's the fourth palace, with the false wall. Like,
yeah, there's nothing. There's a couple of false walls. It's brutal.
Yeah, like I don't recall. Like, I was using a walkthrough because some of those palaces are just mazes, and I don't recall there even being like a visual clue that the wall is false. So. It's like one of those things. It's like what I guess, like, you just spend a few hours in there and you just start hitting your head off the wall and notice that there's an empty space. I guess I don't know.
I wonder if there's an NPC in one of the villages that says something, because I think almost every secret, I think, is tipped off in some way. I don't think they expect you to just run into the walls without some kind of, like, hint about that. So I wonder if an NPC somewhere says, like, oh, you know, the Palace of the Sea has, you know, a wall that you can, you know, or a path you cannot see. Or I don't know. Something that's written in a very hard to understand.
And a Nintendo ploy to get people to call into the hotline and the...
Oh yeah,
earn that toll, earn those tolls.
That's what I mean.
There wasn't DLC back then.
$20 phone call.
Yeah, no DLC and loot boxes. Instead, they got you by tips and recording helmet. <walls. laughs> I remember
Nintendo made more off the hotline than the actual game stuff.
I remember one time I didn't use the hotline, but this was for Super Mario RPG, and we'd borrowed it from my brother's friend who's. You know, my brother's like 4.5 years older than me. So I remember I had to be freaking like a stupid little 7-year-old. Couldn't figure it out. So I'd like called my brother's friend, like, please help me. I can only imagine like getting a phone call from your brother's little friend, you know, like, oh, God. But it was for free. So.
And how much, what was the bill? How much did you bill you afterwards?
Yeah, yeah. Luckily, I forwarded that to my brother.
For renting the game from him and for the free advice. Yeah, that was pretty good.
Perry's official opinion on Zelda 2.
Well, when asked by Kotaku what my least favorite game that Miyamoto created was, I said that although it's still good, I was disappointed that the team was unable to branch out beyond the game's initial concept. And I was talking about Zelda 2.
Well, there you have it.
It's your least favorite game.
I was just reading. Kotaku asked Miyamoto what his least favorite game he created was.
Oh, Miyamoto's least favorite game is Zelda 2.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, so man. I don't think
I should fly to Japan.
Even Miyamoto's on our side, Jordan.
Well, I saw too. Apparently, right? Like, it was almost an entirely new team working on this game. I believe Miyamoto had like a producer role on it. And I forget, one other guy had worked on the first one, but otherwise it was practically like a brand new team working on this. So
yeah, and it makes sense. It's such a different game, right? To have to go from like the top-down view exclusively to also adding this side view for half of the game, you know, villages, the experience point system, you know, they're probably trying to, you got to think like adding the RPG elements, a little bit prescient, right? Because now every game has RPG elements like Zelda 2 had, you know, where you're gaining levels and stats and all that stuff. But, you know, I wonder if like maybe trying to capitalize on the success of something like Dragon Warrior, right? Or Dragon Quest, sorry. Yeah. Like Dragon Quest is such a huge thing in Japan. Like I wonder if they were trying to like, you know, okay, our next Zelda should be closer to Dragon Quest in some way, and maybe that was in the cards too.
Do we what year was Zelda 2 released in America? Do we remember that? Well, I guess yeah. I guess it would have been because I was going to say trying to think because I know Dragon Warrior 1, you know, which is Dragon Quest, like bombed in America so much that they gave it away with your subscription to Nintendo Power. So, but I guess obviously they would have been developing this with the Japanese, you know, market in mind. And then the
January 87 on Famicom, and then it came over to the NES December 1st, 1988.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I'm just looking.
So I wonder how many Dragon Quest games would have been out.
Dragon Quest, the first one was released in 1986, May 27th.
Okay.
So yeah, it could have been like, oh, wow,
so
this is...
at least one. So it could have been something like that. Yeah, because even the first one was pretty big in Japan, I think, right? Like, it was still pretty popular, and then they couldn't, for whatever reason, the West just wasn't interested in that.
It's so funny that
they gave it away. So I'm curious if that Miyamoto quote came before or after Star Fox Zero.
Oh, God, I really hope.
Star Fox Zero wasn't horrible.
Are you really comparing
I will
Zelda
say,
to
I had
Star
more
Fox
fun
Zero?
Playing Star Fox Zero than I have been playing Link.
Harry, what's the good one in that exchange?
Yeah, Star Fox Zero is playable and fun. Zelda 2 is playable.
Star Fox Zero isn't playable because if you get motion sickness, you can't actually play it. You're not going to get motion sickness.
Well, if you got motion sickness, then you don't deserve to play it.
That's a stupid reason for anything. Yeah, agreed.
Then get out of here. Jinx. Well, at least we know the OG Talk Nintendo boys know what's up.
Yeah, exactly.
I thought Alex was supporting us here.
I don't know.
He's a teeter. He's on the fence.
I mean, Talk Nintendo podcast signs my paycheck, so whatever they think
they
I think.
Darn straight.
He's like, whatever I got to do not to edit, I'll say it.
if they're paying you to say you like Star Fox Zero, they're not paying you enough.
You know, somehow Alex convinced...
That's a fair
somehow
point.
Somehow Alex convinced us to write our paychecks, so...
Yeah, yeah.
Should have brought him in a long time ago. There.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol. Get going.
Well, I know we've had some good fun at Zelda 2's expense, but maybe we should move on to Last Call and we can all share. We're all Legend of Zelda fans here for certain. Like maybe not necessary. I imagine 2 would probably fall down our list quite far, if not
right
at
off
the bottom
it.
Of the barrel. But
I need to spite everyone and put Zelda 2 higher.
But we definitely like some Legend of Zelda games, so maybe we want to kind of go around the room and find out what our favorite Legend of Zelda title is.
Oh, gosh.
And Alex, do you want to kick
Perry's,
this off?
Perry's a Star Fox Zero. I know that already.
That's not a Zelda game, Jordan.
Wasn't an Arwing in the code for Ocarina of Time?
Yes, John.
Touche, Perry. Touche.
I got you, Perry. Don't worry.
Thanks, buddy.
He's like, that's going to be an extra $20.
I'll kick it off. I'll say an interesting answer to the best Zelda question, or favorite Zelda question, and that is... The Legend of Zelda: The Minish Cap. I like
answer.
That one a lot.
It's a good answer. I like it.
That's a really good one. I like the Kinstone stuff a lot.
That's your favorite Zelda?
I think it has a lot of color. Breath of the Wild's amazing. Ocarina of Time's amazing. Link's Awakening DX, all amazing. But like the one that's closest to my heart and was like the first Zelda game that clicked for me, absolutely Minish Cap.
Mm, that's awesome.
Interesting.
I like it. I originally played Minish Cap on GBA, but never finished it. I didn't finish it until I ended up playing it through on the 3DS. I think it's a Minish Cap is a ambassador game, if I'm not mistaken. So I played it through when I was on a cruise ship, actually. I was kind of feeling a little bit seasick, so I went back to my room, and I just played Minish Cap, and I loved it going through. I played through the whole thing in, like, a couple days, and, yeah, I think it's definitely one of the most underrated, and I'd love to see it make some kind of comeback. It's got a cool, really cool graphical style, and, yeah, it's just a fun game and a fun world to explore. There's lots of kind of side stuff to do in that game.
That's one of those games I had it on GBA. I played it back then. I loved it. And I've just never gone back and played it again, even though I know it's, like, super good. I got to put... That should be... We should have done the crossover of that one instead of freaking Zelda 2. What were you doing?
You know, it's funny because you mentioned that because it is the only game I can remember, quote-unquote, grinding for. Because I remember the boss was so hard and you can, like, opt to go back and get more heart containers. And I did that. I just remember that part of the game, like fighting the knights in the castle, and I remember it being tough and going back and getting some more hearts and stuff. So, in that way, it's kind of like an RPG, you know, that kind of that feeling in the same way. But yeah, good, great game and beautiful, and I just love the concept and the concept art, and you know, and that weird Snagrit hat, you know, yep. It's just fabulous. Yeah, that should definitely return. I would love a remake of that.
Cutesy wootsy, let's do it.
For sure.
No, I want like a hardcore like scary version of it. Mm. Where it actually is a Snagrit from Pikmin on the
Well, Perry, what's your official favorite Legend of Zelda title?
Oh, that's such a tough question. I would say I'm gonna say the three that I'm torn between, and then I'll tell you my favorite, which is Ocarina of Time 3D, Wind Waker HD, and Skyward Sword.
Mm.
And I'm gonna go with Wind Waker HD.
There it is.
It's a good answer.
That's a good answer too.
That is a good one. That game.
I'm ridiculous. Surprised that Skyward pops in there so highly for you. You're gonna pick the re-release up, right?
I love Skyward. Oh. Yeah,
we'll be jamming.
Oh,
I'd
yeah.
like to hear, Perry, if after playing the HD version, if it goes up to your favorite based on the changes they make and just, you know, the new presentation and everything. I wonder if it'll rise up your rank there.
Maybe, yeah. I don't know. We'll find out. Yeah.
Stay tuned.
How about you, Casey?
It's probably really depends on the day you ask me, but usually it's between Majora's Mask and Link to the Past. See, A Link to the Past has, like, the that was my real first Zelda game I ever actually really played, you know? Like, we had an NES, maybe I played the first two at some point, little dabbling, you know? But, like, Link to the Past is really the first one I remember, and hold that one, you know, super close to my heart. But I just love Majora's Mask's vibe and theme, and, like, so that game is just... masterful, and especially the 3D version, right? Like, sort of made the Bomber Notebook a little bit easier to handle, and all those side quests. So, we'll go with Majora's Mask.
How about you, Jordan?
Yeah, well, I'm actually glad Casey went with Majora's Mask, which I think is it's still probably an underrated title. I think the fact that it's so kind of similar to Ocarina of Time maybe is one reason that, one thing that might have turned some people off of it. But I think Majora's Mask, the 3DS version is very cool. It's not one of my favorites, though, because I prefer the 2D games. So Link Between Worlds, I love. I've only played through it once. I really enjoyed it. I just haven't had time to go back and play through it again, and I think I would like it even more I could appreciate it even more if I played through it more. I'll go Link to the Past. I think Link to the Past is like quintessential Zelda for me. Like, I always prefer the 2D games. You know, it's just like an RPG fan preferring like turn-based combat. Like, I prefer the original kind of 2D top-down Zelda games. Like, I like those dungeons, the puzzles, the music is incredible. It's a really cool world, and then it becomes an even bigger world when you enter the Dark World.
And the
it's
music.
Got one of those. It's got like the music's incredible, especially the Dark World theme. The Kakariko Village is fantastic. Love the palace theme too. The thing about Zelda, it does the Final Fantasy VI thing of, like, you know, you think you're at the end, and then there's a whole new world to explore, a whole new dark world. And I think Zelda Link to the Past is fantastic. There's so many good Zelda games, though. But yeah, for me, it's that 2D staple, and, you know, Super Nintendo, you can't beat
Link to the Past is like a nice warm blanket on a cold day.
Oh yeah, if you needed some comforting, some cheering up, like, you're not playing Star Fox Zero because that's crap. But you know, you would definitely go back to something that's actually playable.
Zelda 2,
and very much accessible.
Zelda
now.
2 is a nice warm blanket on a super hot day.
No, it's like a sandpaper blanket. but we've got four different Zelda games
fire.
Here, though. So I'm interested to see David's.
Well, it's funny. I guess I'm kind of like you, Casey, where it depends. Sometimes it depends on the day you ask me, or the last Zelda I played, or something like that. You guys pretty much picked a lot of the ones I would have picked, like A Link Between
David,
Worlds.
Don't there's no shame in saying Zelda 2. There's no shame. Like, it's a really solid game.
He
73% on Metacritic.
He's a little embarrassed after we railed on it too much now.
Yeah,
that's right.
No, I like all-time favorites, I guess, like Wind Waker HD was the first Wii U game I played, and I loved it on there, especially with, like, having the inventory system on the gamepad and everything. Just absolutely loved that.
The changes for that version are fantastic.
Yeah, loved the Link Between Worlds. Actually, I feel like Link Between Worlds, I prefer Link Between Worlds over A Link to the Past, just because I enjoy. It was basically, to me, it's just like Link to the Past, but with some upgrades. So
heck yeah, dude! Link Between Worlds, amazing. Yeah.
So it's just
that
I
wall
just find it.
Mechanic is amazing.
Yeah, that's super.
It's really,
cool.
Yeah. Really clever.
Yeah. 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 So love that. But what I'll go with, just because no one else has said it, and someone has to take the obvious one, and also because I grew up with an N64, is Ocarina of Time, and not even the DX version. I'm going OG Ocarina of Time.
Not Master Quest.
Not the 3DS version, you mean?
Yeah, like I still enjoy it personally, just because it's easily the one I put the most amount of time into, just from like that's when I had the most amount of time in my life to just spend on video games. So I spent a lot of it playing Ocarina, especially, like, there weren't a ton of N64 games either. So, you know, you buy a few and you just play the crap out of them.
Mm. Yeah, what a great game.
Just got really,
seriously,
really used to the
game.
Nintendo 64. Just got used to the controller. Like, I know it's this, like, weird way of holding a controller and stuff, but it's still, like, you get used to just having your hand set up that way and with the C buttons and the, you know.
Yeah,
you just get used to it.
I had a buddy of mine, and his wife said, who's a good friend of mine as well. Well, kind of. You'll see. She said, Ocarina of Time. She's like, Ocarina of Time is just not a good game. And I was like,
and I never
the strike to my nervous system, like what happened in my body when she said that. And I was kind of like, I cringed my neck and I was like, but that's wrong. That is just not simply not true. Like, I can't say
false.
Anything.
Objectively false. How can you say
that? There are facts.
Exactly.
Otherwise.
Yeah. And she's like, well, I understand, like, for, like, when it came out, but, like, nowadays it's just kind of hard to play. And I'm just like, like, no, that's not true. Like,
go
that's
play.
Seriously is still not true.
There's so many more games.
I just,
yeah, go back
I
and
refuse.
Play that.
And, I haven't really recovered from that since, so.
I can see an argument made for, like, once the 3DS version came out, the N64 version does become harder to go back to, because you see the improvements made in that handheld version. And it's like, yeah, you know, the quality of life, the presentation, everything, it just feels a lot better to play that game, I think. And it's got gyro aiming, I think, if I'm not mistaken. So I don't know. I can buy that side of it. Like, you know, once you play the 3DS one, you kind of want to just play that.
The
version.
Only bad thing,
I think, what's telling though.
I was gonna say the only bad thing about the 3DS remakes is that they're so good that they're, you know, that it's hard to go back to the N64 version. But sometimes it's like, I just want to play that on the TV. You know what I mean? Like
oh,
that's
sure,
my
sure.
only
yes.
qualm with the 3DS versions. It's like. I just want to play Ocarina of Time on the TV, and I think I've got the GameCube disc somewhere lying around, which would be easier than the N64 for sure. But still, it's like a pain in the neck. I just wish they would re-release these. I don't care if they bundled, you know, honestly, Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, if they wouldn't charge me $60 on that for one cart, like, I don't care. I would do it. It's like
just, 60 for one of them on one cart.
No,
hook, line, and sinker.
I mean, if I had to, I probably still would. Like that's my biggest thing is like those games are so like epic at times, you know, right? Like that, I just want to see it on the big screen.
You want it on the TV, yeah? I get that. You know, there's a funny thing about Ocarina of Time is it was kind of the justification for having an N64. Like, you know, a lot of my friends had PlayStations, and you know, there's not a ton you could say. Like, the PlayStation 1 lineup was stellar, especially for RPG fans. But like, at the very least, if you had an N64 and, you know, you're talking trash to your buddies on the playground, like, oh, you know, we've got Final Fantasy 7, we've got, you know, Crash Bandicoot, we've got, you know, Twisted Metal, we've got all these cool games, and like, hey, you don't have Ocarina of Time. Like, you don't have, you know, what could be the greatest video game of all time. So sorry, you got a lot of great games on PlayStation for sure, but like, you don't have, like,
no one cares.
You know, arguably the best game ever. So there you did have that in your quill or in your cab if you only had an N64.
Yeah, that was my neighbors. They traded their N64 for a PlayStation. And I remember being like, what a bunch of idiots. but then they were playing.
And then you spend every weekend playing their games.
I spent every weekend watching my freaking neighbor play Diablo, not letting me play. That son of a gun.
Oh gosh, yeah.
on a parting note, though, is the lack of dungeons in Breath of the Wild the reason that none of us immediately went there?
I'd say so. Like to me, I think Breath of the Wild is probably the most fun I've ever had playing a Zelda game, but it's not my favorite Zelda game.
Hmm. I think it's the best Zelda game. Yeah. But it's not my personal favorite. I think you know what it does is amazing, and like it with the pairing this the Breath of the Wild with the advent of the Switch was, you know, you can't replicate that. Like it was magic. But it's just not my favorite game. I do love it though.
It's so far from the traditional concept of a Zelda game, as good as it is, that I think when you think, like, what is my favorite Zelda game, you think of the way that, like, Skyward Sword and pre-Skyward Sword Zelda makes you feel. And just, I guess my brain didn't even, like, approach Breath of the Wild as an actual option for as good of a game as it is.
Yeah, I just sometimes even forget it's a Zelda game. Like, if you take out all the names and throw different names on, like, it could easily just be a different... totally different franchise, really. Like it's such a departure, but yeah, it'll be interesting to see with Breath of the Wild 2 if they
more like Majora, like,
if dungeons, I think, is just so quintessentially Legend of Zelda that like you have to put them back in the sequel, you would think. Like, I don't know,
they unless they
I think just, that, I think that's a slam dungeons. Dunk I think it's I think it's a slam dunk they, to get traditional
there was nobody
there's
no en- there was no enemies in the dungeons. It was just like
we want proper
5 minutes of walking around an empty room.
Semantics.
What's great about Zelda is like we've all got a different favorite game, and I think we could all understand why this game or you know every person's game would be their favorite. Like there's a case to be made for so many games in this franchise to be a favorite, to be the best. Like they all do something so. Please just stop. 50 minutes of there, almost an hour of this. My head's gonna explode. I'm sure there'll be a few more shots, but you take my point though, right? Like there's so many good things that these Zelda games do that you can understand why they're so like cherished and beloved, and you want to go back to them, and you want to have them all like accessible right now. Like we want all of these games on Switch to be able to bring with us or throw them on the big screen because you know they're just so fun and they're so engrossing.
I think the fact that there's a 2D Zelda and a 3D Zelda has greatly benefited them because it's prevented Zelda fatigue. Mm-hmm. Because you can, like, by bouncing from one to the other, it gives a bigger gap between the specific ones. So I definitely think, like, I don't know if it was, if Miyamoto was, you know, planning 30 years ahead or whatever when they started bouncing back and forth from Ocarina and all the different ones, but I definitely feel like they've done a good job of refreshing each title in a way that, like you said, there's something for everyone, and mm-hmm. it keeps like the longtime people happy enough that we're, you know, because you always get like the Mario. To me, like there's been a few Mario titles where it's like, this isn't much different, you know. Like, so I think they've done a great job with the franchise that way.
Yeah. Yeah, they all feel very different, distinct, and really enjoy. Even you know, I said Majora's Mask, you know, kind of just retread Ocarina, but it's so different in tone.
It retreads assets. You know what I mean? Like otherwise, it's such a different game.
Yeah, it does play very differently with the time cycle. You know, like, there's a lot of things that are.
I'll never forget my brother playing it the first time. Like, this game sucks. He's like, what is this 3-day BS? And I don't think he ever played another Zelda game again, actually.
Can we do a little bonus last call? Just a very quick, like, lightning or thunder round here. Like, none of us love Zelda 2, fine. But if it
whoa, whoa,
there
whoa,
have
whoa.
Been rumors about a
you
remake.
You love Zelda 2.
I do love Zelda 2. I do.
Well, you're one of us.
I don't think I've shied. I don't feel like one of you today, but I don't think I've shied away from that opinion. If there have been some rumors about the game being remade, you know, I don't think that's impossibility. So, if the game were to be remade, like, what is like your kind of the number one thing you'd want to see? And don't say like, oh, make it fun or make it not terrible. Like, what's a legitimate, concrete thing you'd want to see in a remake of this game?
I guess. You go first, David. I don't know what I'm talking about.
I was like, new dungeons. Yep. I the dungeons seem a little too simplistic and a little too
corridory.
Like, yeah, right. Like you can easily not know where you are at any given moment. Like you're like, did I turn left? Did I turn right? What's going on? Like I don't want to have to utilize like a picture of the dungeon and try to figure out where I am. Like I'd like to see something. Some better design of the dungeon to make it a little more, because it's kind of Metroidvania in a way of like, okay, I got to go to this part to get this key, and then I got to retread back to get to this door, and then I have to go over here to get the item. You know, I maybe just a little more consistency in the dungeon design for me.
I mean, it feels very similar to the original Metroid, right? Like where you're almost encouraged to draw your own map of it so you don't get lost. And there is no map screen, like you can't see where you are on the map, and because everything looks the same, it's even worse than Metroid a little bit, because at least Metroid, like,
they
the rooms change color, and like there's different background elements so you can distinguish the rooms, there's just more of them. But yeah, in Zelda 2, everything is the same, the dungeon will have its theme color, you know, green or gray or purple or whatever, and then the whole thing just looks like that, with like maybe an elevator in the middle and, you know, a bridge or some one of those, the rooms filled with blocks that you can eventually destroy when you get the power glove and stuff like that. But yeah, I think it's a good call.
Yeah, I think just sort of along the same lines, but I guess more with the map discussion at least, just more direction, you know, maybe not necessarily like, oh, like give you a map and like put a ping mark on it, like, oh, go here, you know, but just not so obtuse. Just the obtuseness. And like I said, that's a big thing with Zelda 1 with me as well, is just I don't want to just like trial and error it until I figure it out, you know, like give me something.
Okay, quick question for a quick follow-up. Should we keep in I am error?
You can allow that, yes.
Okay. You got to keep him in.
I don't
Alex
know how
Perry,
you have
that you guys. That's true.
I would do either like a better block or a dodge with some invincibility frames. Because I think the dinky shield you get now, I think 20% of the game's frustration is down to getting caught into fights because the combat gets so unfair, but unjustifiably unfair, if that makes sense. And just something to give you a little bit of a defensive edge, I would say, would alleviate a lot
of
the stresses.
Like a parry or a riposte or some kind of, dodge mechanic would be pretty cool.
More
variety in general, I would say, because even, like, you eventually get, like, the up jab or, like, the up stab and the down stab or whatever, but I don't feel like I was using that all that often. Like, I was still doing mostly, like, the crouching down, jumping up, crouching down. Like, I felt like that they needed to make the enemy, maybe make the enemies more, like the combat itself, just more forcing me to use the other ways, not just up and down, up and down, you know?
Parry?
Yeah.
I think that the game would be better.
What did Miyamoto say?
If
it's perfect the way it is, yeah.
No. I was thinking instead of a platformer, maybe if it was like a series of incredibly tiny, like 5 second long random games.
Like a micro game?
Yeah, I think that would be cool. And they could do like a whole different spin on it. It could be Zelda 2. And maybe, you know, Link is trying to sell these games.
I was going
to
say, do you think Wario should actually just replace Link in this game?
Oh, duh. Sorry. Yeah. No, they already have that. It's WarioWare.
There it is. Perfect.
Okay, give me 10 minutes. I would like silence too.
You should
about
be happy.
Just let me think. No,
you'll find out on the other end of the Talk Nintendo podcast what Perry thinks.
Yeah, no, I think the main problem is just I just think it's the very much like just the hardcore punishment. You know, just quality of life upgrades would be great. Better physics, better attacks. I mean, I think just it's a game where you can't really. It's not like Link's Awakening where you can reskin it and it'll be good. It'll be amazing. It's a game where it needs a fundamental change, but I shouldn't say fundamental. It needs a lot of change, but the idea is there. I mean, it's a Zelda Metroid game. You know, it's awesome, and it's you're right. I mean, all the risks it took and stuff to make it separate is just so cool. Like everyone else would have just. You know, I'm so glad they didn't do Zelda 2 just like they did Super Mario Bros. 2. You know, like Super Challenge, you know, like that kind of a thing. They did something really different, and it was really cool. I just think it was unfortunately the worst aged Zelda game. But it really took a lot of. It's a really cool idea, and you know what our last call should have been was what Zelda game should be remade the most? And I would absolutely say Zelda 2. It would be a perfect remake.
My answer is we can't change anything about it. I wouldn't change anything because it's perfect.
Mm-hmm.
No,
or that.
I mean,
or that.
Everyone's brought up a lot of good points. You know, it does need a lot of TLC to bring it up to, a more accessible and playable standard. But I think it's still fun to go back to, and I do hope they remake it, because I think that, you know, it's a black sheep in the franchise, and it's so different and unique that I'd love to see what they could do with a new version of it. So.
Isn't it weird that they've never remade the first game? Isn't that weird? Like, they remade Link's Awakening, and it's awesome. But, like, yeah. I don't know why they didn't do that for the first one, and then they could have done 2, and then Link's Awakening, and blah, 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 you know? That's just crazy to me.
I mean, the first one's funny because I don't think it's aged very well either. I think
no,
it's
it hasn't. It's aged better
game,
though,
right?
It's aged better.
A little better. But Link's Awakening, though, the Game Boy version has aged tremendously. That game is still a ton of fun to play, even the original version. Okay.
Of what? The original version of what?
We're gonna need another podcast.
I don't want to item shuffle every time I need to use a different item in every single room 8 times.
That's the only
and boy is that
that's
a big old
part of it. It's
not technical. That's a technical limitation.
Well, that's
too.
Yeah, and, that's a quality of life change. Easy, but no, I know.
Exactly.
But it's funny,
and that's something that doesn't ruin the game.
I mean, it sort of does.
That you could bring that with you portably and play it on the Game Boy is a marvel.
I mean, when you got to switch out in every room, that becomes so tedious. And like David said, I know that was a hardware constraint at the time. So, like, you know, and they've obviously addressed it in the remake, but, man, like, that's...
Casey, maybe you had to switch out items in every room, but a good Zelda player just figures it out.
Yeah, well...
I know Parry didn't change items once. He used a shield.
Well, call me Jerry, then.
Yeah. I'll support you on this one, Jordan. Link's Awakening, I think, has aged well for me.
Oh, yeah, that game is...
Can't wait to play it on my Game & Watch.
You know, it hasn't aged well.
Me too, Parry, me too.
Oh, you already know, Jordan. I'm not even going to say it.
Oh, you're going to say Zelda 2 or Octopath. I don't even know which one at this point. So.
You know which one.
Take your pick.
Gosh, yeah. All right. Of course, we always have to end on the most sour notes.
Might be a good place to end.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say thanks for joining us, everybody. And like, but then everybody also includes these three. So I don't know. I have nothing against
thank,
Alex.
Thank
Alex
the Discord.
Side, so.
Thank the Discord people for giving you.
I do.
To,
I do.
For backing
yeah.
you up. Backing you up.
Please, please. Okay, we're going to. I'm going to make my own Discord of just people who agree with me. I'm gonna
did I say anything that you disagree with?
With me.
Didn't I say. I mean, what did I say
well,
that you disagree
you think
with?
Star Fox Zero is good.
It's better than this but game.
I vehemently
it's Jordan
agree
against
with that.
The world.
I never
He's
said
always
that.
Just looking for
well,
enemies.
I think I did say it's good. Star Fox is good. It's a solid. That's a okay. solid 6.57 game.
Perry, there's only one way to settle it. I'll put
wait,
up
wait,
a
wait, wait,
poll.
Hold on, hold
we'll
on.
Do a Twitter
are
poll,
we
Zelda 2 versus Star Fox Zero, and we'll see who wins.
Do, hold on, are we not? Do you guys think that Star Fox Zero is less than a 6.5?
No.
Yeah, it's
no
6.5
higher
than
max.
I said 6.57.
I'd give it
okay?
a 7. That's a
depending
7.
On the day.
The wabi-sabi, baby.
Yeah, so let's not...
Don't
yeah.
don't add the slash 7. No, you got to pick a score. Come
I think
on.
That someone 7? Just wants to...
Wabi-sabi.
Just. I think someone lives on these little rivalries, and that's okay. You know
we'll
what?
See what Twitter says.
You know
actually,
what? Hey, you know what, Jordan? Star Fox Zero is a 9. You know what? I love that game. Okay, now say what you will. Say what you will.
I yeah. do too.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, George. Say what you need to.
Thanks everybody for joining us for the final crossover with the Thursday for the Talk Nintendo podcast. You know, congratulations on 250 episodes, but I don't think we'll be able to continue our you know once every couple months getting together with them. You know, they're so
yeah, because
busy
Perry's agreeing
now.
With you too
don't
much.
Don't worry, guys.
Just,
we're just
many,
not
too many voices,
invite Jordan
you know,
next
and,
time.
We're just hoping sounds to good. You know meet with some people who have got better opinions about video games and you know, just see what else is out there and yeah no I love you guys and I appreciate the you know that we can you know talk about games that we don't all have the same feelings about and that's fine you know if people want to like Star Fox Zero they're free to and I think that it does some cool things with the gamepad that I'm just
I think Jordan at the end
Perry,
of the day
think it's a 9,
is
more
just
power
upset because he can't have milk and we can.
I'm always.
I think we all agree that Star Fox
that,
Zero
that
is a 6.5.
Sure.
So I don't. I'm sorry. I wish I could be on this bandwagon with you, but we all agree on the same thing.
I should have talked about this during the food segment. So I had some milk on Friday.
Oh,
no, Sunday. It was my brother's birthday on Friday, and so. He had a birthday cake, a creamsicle birthday cake that apparently was made with lactose-free milk. And I guess
does that make
you know,
it milk?
Lactose-free milk is fine for some people. It's lactose-free milk tastes the same as regular milk. I mean, I would challenge you to find the difference. But they add the enzyme or they add like the ingredient that is in this in the lactose pills that people would take. Right? They just add that to
oh,
the
to
milk
like counteract
already.
It.
So it's not. If they don't actually, it's not actually lactose free. The lactose is still in there. They just add that enzyme to help you digest it. Pretty much, yeah. So I had this cake with the lactose free milk. I guess it was made with. And I honestly was out for 2 days. Like I was feeling
oh, no.
like crap for 2 days. And that's the first time I'd had milk in probably years. Like at least intentionally, you know. And yeah, that
I was gonna say. I guess at the end
well.
Of the day, was it worth it? What was it good?
The cake was very good. Creamsicle cake. Come on,
that
that's
does
a really
sound
good
amazing.
Flavor for a cake. So
is that
creamsicle
cream
is a good flavor for anything?
Icicle?
You know, what's that?
What is a creamsicle cake?
Creamsicle.
What?
It had like it had vanilla cake and then like orange frosting. Like
oh,
it was delicious.
Oh, gotcha,
like
gotcha.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
Yeah. That's how they made it creamsicle.
We
flavor,
call that
so.
Something else here. I can't remember. Maybe that is what we call it. I haven't thought about that for years. Yeah. Dude,
yeah.
Heck yeah. Those are amazing.
I mean, as a kid, you know, as a kid, name a better popsicle than a creamsicle.
No,
on a hot
that
day,
is the
like
best.
Today or something. Oh, yeah. It's the best. Yeah. But
almost
anyways,
as good
yeah.
as Star Fox Zero.
I knew we had to, I'm trying to wrap up before you said anything else about Star Fox Zero. But yeah, obviously, I want to thank the Talk Nintendo boys for joining us. You know, always fun to get together. And thanks everybody for listening. You know, the Discord is great to hear, you know, feedback and comments from the Discord. So, you know, whenever we've got a game coming up and David, you know, is asking for people to share, please do. You know, we love to hear from everybody. And there's always so many good conversations happening on the Discord that if we can share some of those feelings about upcoming games, you know, all the better. So, you know, keep those thoughts coming, you know, emails, if it's messages, tweets, whatever it is, you know, we're welcoming them with open arms. But yeah, I guess we should shout out, you know, Talked in a Podcast, 250 episodes. You know, that is an incredible achievement, guys. You know, bring on Alex. You know, I'm sure you're going to be able to get to 500. Perry will probably have like 10 kids by then or something like that, but I'm sure he'll still push through. Maybe he'll miss an episode and I'll have to fill in.
He'll be at 240 or at 490.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. Yeah. Do you guys want to shout out anything for the podcast?
I'm not making that mistake again, by the way.
I'm gonna
record something.
Which one?
Yeah.
Jordan and David, as the front man of Talk Nintendo Podcast, I just want to say on behalf of us three,
Alex,
thank you so much
for having us. You are welcome back anytime, my friend.
He's our PR guy.
Oh, my God.
Yes! I hate Star Fox Zero now.
We've got an open chair for you at all times. I know. Here's the problem. Now that I've shown my disdain for that game, I know Perry's next punishment for me.
Ooh,
I know what it's going to be.
I don't do that. Casey does that. No, don't show your weaknesses to Casey.
I already know what my punishment to Jordan will be at some point, and it sure as heck isn't going to be.
Why do we have all the Jordan punishments ready to go? Like, I don't like how mine are like pre-planned or pre-scripted or something.
Because
hey, by the way, have you started on Balan Wonderworld? Alex is a monster.
I haven't. It was like, Casey, what did you find at the sale price? Like 20 bucks
like
or something
30
like
bones.
That for it? Yeah, yeah.
It was 30, but it went down to 20.
No,
like,
Jerry, you know what that means. We overpaid.
That's what I want. I want that sale. I need that sale up here. I need to find Craigslist and someone giving it away for free.
If you go digging around the dump, I'm sure you'll find some copy somewhere.
Oh man.
This is the longest officially last call like segment we've ever had. So that, you know, we've set another record for the big 250. So that's a good one. But you know, people know where to find us. You know, at Talk Nintendo Podcast at Talk Nintendo POD at the Thirsty Mage, where you can find us. You know, but you know, please subscribe, like, comment, all those great things. You can, you know, check out our wonderful content. And yeah, I'm sure we'll be getting together again soon. Can't imagine what game we're going to play, as long as it's not
Balan Wonderworld.
Well, yeah, that will be the one we'll be talking about.
That.
Yeah.
As long as it's not that, yeah. But yeah, thanks everybody for joining us. Thanks guys for being with us, and hope everybody has a good night.
Goodbye.
Adios.
Bye.
Bye.
Star Fox Zero.